Hello, good evening, everyone. How was dinner? Yeah, are we ready for our next speaker? Awesome. I have the distinct privilege to introduce our final speaker of the evening, Peggy Grande. Peggy Grande was executive assistant to US President Ronald Reagan from 1989 to 1999 after he left the White House. She is author of the book, The President Will See You Now, My Stories and Lessons from Ronald Reagan's Final Years. She is an international keynote speaker, TV and radio commentator, and widely published opinion writer. She was chair of World for Brexit and was national spokesperson for a California ballot initiative. Peggy served as a presidential appointee and considers it the honor of a lifetime to have worked for two presidents of the United States in both support and strategic roles. She serves on the board of Pepperdine University's School of Public Policies and the board of the Center for American Ideas. She is a graduate of Pepperdine University and a mother of four. Please join me in welcoming Peggy Grande.
It's so exciting to be here. I've been to this beautiful campus. I've spoken mostly out at the campus in Santa Barbara before, but it's really exciting to be here today to see all these incredible young people here. And so thank you for inviting me. Yaf, thank you for having me. It is a pleasure and a privilege. Okay, where are my slides? There we are. So thank you for coming out. I know it's been a really long day for everybody. I tend to talk fast, so that'll play in your favor, hopefully keep everybody awake. But what a pleasure and a privilege to be here. And like Hunter mentioned, I feel like one of the luckiest women in the world. I had the opportunity of a lifetime to serve as executive assistant to President Ronald Reagan in his post-presidency years. So let me tell you a little bit about how it started. And I know you're talking a lot over the last yesterday and tomorrow about policy. And we're actually going to talk a little bit about the character of the man. You know, who was Ronald Reagan? I'm sure your parents and grandparents, a lot of them are really obsessed with Ronald Reagan, and you maybe wonder why. So hopefully you'll know Ronald Reagan a little bit better when I'm done speaking with you tonight. We're going to talk a little bit about how he led, how he lived, and how he left a lasting legacy, why we're still talking about him after all these years. So many of you can probably relate to me. Here I am, little bird legs in some homemade outfit that my mother made. God love you, mother. Standing outside the White House, I think I was about 7 years old. I stood outside the White House gates and I peered into the gates and I said to my mother, I wonder what you have to do to work there. I was born and raised in Southern California. It might as well have been a million miles from Washington, D.C., but I was kind of this nerdy little kid, and I loved presidents and politics and government, and every book I read was about presidents or first ladies, and I don't know where I got that love, but that was just something I was super passionate and excited about. Never thought in a million years I would ever have a chance to actually work in that arena. It was just kind of a fun little side thing that I was into. But fast forward my life, and I am so grateful for every opportunity that I've had to serve. Like Hunter said, not only work for President Reagan, I served as a presidential appointee under President Trump for the last year of his administration, and have had experiences and opportunities all over the world to talk about things that I'm passionate about and care about, everything from executives to top political leaders to students like yourself. And honestly, don't tell any of the other audiences, but the student groups are always my favorite. So thank you for coming out tonight, because I can relate to you. And I actually wish that I had known about conferences like this and had the opportunity to attend conferences like this when I was young. So fast forward my life, I have an opportunity to sit right outside the White House now in my current role working for the White House Historical Association, just waiting for my chance to get back into the White House in 2025. And I know you all will be very helpful in making sure that we take back the White House at the end of 24. But let me tell you a little bit about President Reagan. And I wrote a lot about him in my book, not as a president, but just as a person, the type of person that he was. And one of the things I loved about President Reagan is there was no disconnect between what you hear about him and what he was really like. I'm going to start by telling a very embarrassing story about myself, and I'm actually going to read it out of my book, because I don't know how many of you have had a hero that you admired from afar, that maybe you were really enamored with, and you finally get a chance to meet them, and how does that go? And maybe it doesn't go quite as well as you had hoped. I'm going to embarrass myself, but it's in my book, so I've had to get over doing it publicly, but see if any of you can relate to maybe having a moment like this. So let me back up just a little bit. I was a student at Pepperdine University. Again, I had loved the presidency, had followed it. Ronald Reagan was president of the United States when I was in junior high, high school, and college. And he was, of course, the great communicator. I was a communications major in college because I didn't think politics would ever be something I would really go into, so I didn't even study it. But I was a communications major, and of course, Ronald Reagan, as the great communicator, was somebody that I followed very closely. He left the White House. He came back to Los Angeles to open his post-presidency office. And my dad had raised me to believe that somebody's got to have the job you want, and it might as well be you. So I took a chance, wrote a letter to the office of Ronald Reagan, never even thinking I would hear back from them. I was called in for an interview, was very excited, but terrified. I was working for Nordstrom at the time, so wardrobe, check, knew exactly what I would wear, something fabulous. And but beyond that, I had no idea what was going to happen or how that would go. Oh, thank you. Isn't he doing a great job? All the tech people here, give it up for the tech guys. I wouldn't know how to do anything without them, so thank you so much for taking care of that. So anyway, I go in for this interview, and I don't know what to expect, but I met with this woman. She was really nice. She was really friendly. She put me at ease, and I thought the interview actually went pretty well. So at the end of the interview, she asks me to go sit in the lobby because she's going to bring me parking validation stickers. So I'm sitting in the lobby and kind of that big exhale thinking, okay, this didn't go too bad. We'll see what happens. And I was expecting her to walk through the door with the parking validations, but instead, let me tell you what happened. Waiting for her in the lobby felt almost like a dream state. It was so foreign to anything I had done or experienced, and yet somehow felt strangely familiar, as if this was all meant to be. The door nearest me suddenly swung open, and four Secret Service agents in suits and ties with earpieces, radios, and guns holstered under their coats walked hurriedly toward me. Did they know who I was? Did they know what I was doing here? Were they going to arrest me or shoot me? And then behind the lead agent, I saw two older gentlemen in golf attire. Wait, was it? Could it possibly be? It was President Ronald Reagan and his golf buddy for the day, Walter Annenberg. In all of my interview prep and planning, it had never even occurred to me that I might actually meet President Reagan. I didn't know what to do, and so I panicked, but I thought about what I would do out of respect if the flag were passing by. So I stood up straight, placed my hand over my heart, and stared nobly and non-threateningly off into the distance. True story. I'm certain I looked completely ridiculous. But instead of walking past me, he walked right toward me. He looked me in the eye and extended his hand. I shook his hand and introduced myself. "Well, hello, Peggy. It's nice to meet you," said the 40th President of the United States of America. I had imagined him as a 10-foot-tall giant. After all, he had been a movie star, a governor, and president of the United States. He had tackled communism head-on, fixed the domestic economy, and solved many of the world's problems. And yet here he was, an ordinary man, just over 6 feet tall. His hair in pictures looked very jet black, but up close I saw touches of gray, evidence of his 78 years. He was ruddy and rosy-cheeked, full of life, happiness, and vitality. His smile was more asymmetrical than I had ever noticed in pictures, and it was perfect in its imperfect way. And those eyes, a wonderful, bright, true blue, carrying so much joy. He was gone as quickly as he appeared, taking all the people, the energy, and the aura of power and importance with him. The office was suddenly eerily still. Selena, the woman who had interviewed me, then walked through the same door, grinning ear to ear, having witnessed my ridiculous salute. It's pretty incredible meeting him for the first time, isn't it? You should have warned me, I said, still trembling inside. No, it's much better this way. And though I felt I had horribly embarrassed myself, I had to agree. She then handed me the parking stickers and said I was going to wait until at least tomorrow to call you and leave you hanging in suspense for at least a while. But I already know that we want you to work here with us. So can you start on Monday? Yes, I can. I held it all together until I was outside the building. I didn't know whether to shout for joy, cry, or drop to my knees in prayers of thanksgiving. I was so overwhelmed by all that had happened, I started laughing out loud. The preposterousness of it all, me, him, this office, Fox Plaza, Avenue of the Stars. We met, he shook my hand, and now I work for him? I had no idea what Monday would hold, but I knew with confidence that my life would never be the same after that day. And in fact, it had already changed. So that's my very embarrassing first moment with Ronald Reagan. I wasn't sure there would be a moment after that, but fortunately I was hired on the spot for what I thought would be a short-term internship. At the end of that internship, the woman who hired me actually returned to Washington, D.C., and they asked me to take her job. And so I was the executive assistant to the chief of staff, who is now the publisher of the Washington Post, Fred Ryan. I worked for him for 2 or 3 years as his EA. And then Ronald Reagan's executive assistant he had had since before he was governor retired. And they asked me to take that job. So you don't say no to a job offer like that, although I wasn't quite sure how I was going to navigate family and life all at the same time. But the Reagans were terrific to work for. I had 3 of my 4 kids while I was working for them. And I wound up staying for 10 years working for President Reagan from 1989 when he left office till 1999 when he left the public eye. He did live another 5 years after that, and I write about in my book some very special visits I had to his house after he announced to the world he had Alzheimer's, and then stayed close with Mrs. Reagan until her passing in 2016. And so 27 years of my life, starting from when I was a senior in college all the way until 2016, were kind of interwoven with the Reagans, and I'm so grateful for the people they were, for all the lessons that they taught me, not just by their words, but by their actions, the type of people they were. So what was it like to work for a former president, and not only a former president, but I think the best one, or at least in the top few? He was really incredible, and okay, we can laugh at the hair and the shoulder pads and all the fashions of the 90s, they're pretty terrible. But it was incredible to have the opportunity to have a front row seat to history, to be able to interact with him in a very personal way, as well as professional way, of course. Being able to travel on private planes with him, I'm in my 20s, it totally ruined and spoiled me, because now I, of course, fly commercial, and it's not nearly as fun as flying this way. But there was just special moments. There were ordinary moments in the office every day, which were special just because they were shared with him. Yes, I wore Burberry before Burberry was really a thing. Again, I was at Nordstrom. We had the fashion down. But it was really an honor to just be able to see him in those quiet moments when there weren't a bunch of people around and to interact with him closely every day. I got to witness historic signatures, travel all over the world with him in private aircraft. One of my favorite jobs, though, was being behind the lens of the camera. So when you're in the White House, you have a White House photographer, and you've got a whole staff of people that do all these things for you. Well, post-presidency, you go from having hundreds, if not thousands, of people working for you, for about a handful of us worked for him. And so on any given day, I would be greeting visitors in the front. I would brief them on the meeting. I would bring them in, have them sign the guest book. I would bring them in and introduce them to President Reagan. I would help monitor or facilitate the meeting. I would have the camera around my neck, take the pictures. If there was some sort of hospitality, I would bring in the snacks. I would usher them out and say goodbye to them and clean the dishes when I was done. I mean, it was kind of one-man band in a lot of ways. You wore a lot of hats and did a lot of things, but it was wonderful to have the opportunity to do all those things. But one of my favorite jobs was being behind the lens of the camera, because this man made me look like a really good photographer, which I was not. Just keep in mind, he had been an actor, and so he always had the perfect posture, the perfect pose, the perfect smile. And so he was wonderful to photograph. And in fact, this photo that's on the front of my book, when I was asked to write the book, I knew not one word that would be between the cover, but I knew that this was the photo that I wanted to be on the cover, because I walked into his office one day and the lighting was just perfect, the way the natural light was coming in from the side. And I walked in, it was just one of those moments that catches your breath. And I said, "Mr. President, you look especially handsome today. Do you mind if I take your picture?" "Well, all right," he says. And so I go and grab the camera. Back in the days when we had film cameras, I snap one photo. He's got this little polka dot tie. He's wearing a golden bear California tie tack. And it was just a great moment. But it just captured that moment in time. He was in this post-presidency. You can see a little bit of gray in his hair. And I just think it captures the warmth and the charm of him in those last years of his life. But I loved it so much, I had it enlarged. It hung up above my desk in the office for those 10 years that I was there. And so when I was approached, I said, "Well, I know what's going to be on the cover. Beyond that, I have no idea, but I do love that cover photo, because it was just one of those moments that I was able to capture." But being behind the lens of the camera, you get to capture all kinds of things. So here is President Reagan with Lady Margaret Thatcher and Mrs. Reagan. He's showing Lady Thatcher through the museum exhibits up at the Reagan Library. And then I would catch moments like this after the event where they're in black tie, formal evening gowns, and the ladies, if you can see, have their shoes kicked off in their stocking feet, and they're deep in conversation, and Ronald Reagan kind of has his eyes rolled in the back of his head like, please stop talking so we can go home. And so I loved these very real moments when you would catch these exceptional people in just these very ordinary moments. If you don't know much about Ronald Reagan's life story, you know, you hear about him as the president, you forget how he began. And he came from very humble beginnings. He was born in Tampico, Illinois, in the middle of a snowstorm in 1911. He was born at home in a little apartment above a store, and his family was very poor. His father was an alcoholic, and if you looked at the cards of life he had been dealt, you would have thought, oh, this poor kid, he will never have a chance, he will never amount to anything. But he didn't let his circumstances define him, and instead he chose to define his circumstances, and thankfully he had a mother who raised him to believe that God has a plan for everyone. And seemingly random twists of fate are all part of his plan. And in the end, everything will work out for the best. And she raised him to believe that. And so only in America story could happen that this little boy from these very dire circumstances could grow up to do and become all that he did, in part because of the love and the faith of his mother, who taught him to believe something different could happen. It wasn't just the sum of his circumstances, that he could multiply and amplify and make something different out of his life. And so we thank his mother for that. He was also a man of authenticity, and a lot of people who are very popular or important or famous, you can tell that they're very full of themselves and they really like themselves, don't they? But Ronald Reagan just had a warmth and a kindness and a charm about him that was very authentic. What you saw was who he was. He was no different in front of the cameras than behind the cameras. And I was talking to a couple of people, who's been up to his ranch? Have you been to a YAF program up at his ranch? Yeah. So you've seen how surprisingly small and modest and humble it was. And this was where the sitting president of the United States used to go when he wanted to vacation and relax. So not palatial, not, you know, very luxurious, very simple, very humble. And I got to go up there with him many times, and he wasn't even embarrassed to take people like Margaret Thatcher up there. The Queen went up there. He loved it. And getting to see the ranch with Ronald Reagan was like getting a glimpse of his heart. You know, he called it his open cathedral. And he really thought that was a place he could reconnect to God by being on that mountaintop. And so I think that was his mother carrying over again into even his adult life. But he even took people like Gorbachev up there. And I write in my book about, you know, one of the many scenarios that I was given where you try to problem solve, and you would never say no to the president, but sometimes it's a little challenging to get to yes. So Gorbachev was going to come up to the ranch, and President Reagan asked me if I would find him a cowboy hat so that he could present him with a cowboy hat to wear up at the ranch. And I thought it was a great idea for some of you maybe from Texas or other places. Simple, no problem, right? Southern California, a little bit more of a problem. But the bigger problem was, if you know cowboy hats, you know they are sized and they have to fit just right. And if they're too small, they sit too high. And if they're too big, they sit too low. So how does one figure out what size hat Gorbachev wears? Now, you may say, oh, Google it. Well, I'm a little older than that. No Google back in the days. So how do you figure out what size hat Gorbachev wears? So I started by staying to the office about 10 o'clock at night to call Moscow in 8 o'clock in the morning to an office, trying to find somebody who could maybe figure this out. Nobody speaks English, little problem and disconnect there. So I went to, back in the days, faxing, draw a picture, questions, arrows on this, you know, hand-drawn page, fax it to Gorbachev's office, hoping somebody understands what I'm trying to ask. So eventually, after trying both of these techniques for a long period of time, I finally got somebody to answer me. And they gave me a number, and it was a really big number. And I thought, oh, that's not a hat size. Well, then I realized it must be a Russian hat size. And if I could only convert a Russian hat size into an American hat size, then maybe we're onto something. Again, no Google. So how do you figure out how to convert a Russian hat size into a Western hat size? So I went to an equestrian center nearby and asked them if they could help me figure this out. So they finally navigated it. I thought I had his hat size. Finding a cowboy hat in LA was also a challenge. But I finally found one, wrapped it up, and so was very nervous that day up at the ranch when President Reagan presents this to President Gorbachev. And I'm thinking, oh no, the moment of truth, right? Drum roll, please. Gorbachev opens the hat, loves it, puts it on, and it fits perfectly. So I'm so proud of myself, kind of patting myself on the back, thinking I did such a great job. All the pictures were taken. He wore it all day, which was fabulous, until the next day when I get back to the office and Stetson, it was a Stetson cowboy hat, Stetson calls me and says, we love that you featured a cowboy hat so prominently, one of ours, on Gorbachev's head, but did you know that Gorbachev put the hat on backwards? I'm not a cowgirl. I don't know these things. So Gorbachev apparently wore this cowboy hat backwards the whole entire day. So the best laid plans. I got the hat, but things don't always go quite as planned. Ronald Reagan was known as the great communicator, but especially for your parents and grandparents, they would also have known him as the great optimist. If you've read anything about the 1970s, taxes were high, inflation was high, unemployment was high. Any of that sound familiar? So America was in this period of malaise, right? Ronald Reagan takes office, and on day one of his presidency, he entirely changes the narrative by using different language, optimistic language. He said, it's morning in America. There's a new dawn ahead. America's best days are yet ahead. And we as Americans, we bought into that. We believed that. We wanted to be part of that. He would look through the lens of the camera from the Oval Office and come right into your living room and inspire you and challenge you because of the language he used. Of course, he backed that up with incredible policy that also gave people tax breaks and re-incentivized people to innovate and build and develop things more. But it really started with the language that he used. And so thinking about your own leadership journey as you go into positions of leadership, realize it's what you do that's very important, but it's how you talk about it. And Ronald Reagan, as not only the great communicator, but the great optimist, made us believe in ourselves. And in fact, at the end of 8 years, when you asked him what he was most proud of during his presidency, it wasn't his policies, it wasn't anything that he had done in office. He said, the thing I'm most proud of is that I made the American people believe in themselves again. And that started on day one. It was a whole new day in America because of the language he used, optimistic language backed up by good policy. He was also a man of strength. You know, I think when I was young, I thought you had to decide, am I going to be a strong and successful person, or am I going to be a kind and good person? But I didn't really think you could do both. And then I met Ronald Reagan. Strong, obviously. President of the United States, went toe-to-toe with Gorbachev, stood at the Brandenburg Gate and told him to tear the wall down. And by the way, that wall came down. But behind that was this man of character, of compassion, of warmth and charm, who would look you in the eye with a little twinkle and a sparkle. And so I realized very soon after meeting him that you could be strong and successful, and you could be a kind, good person, and those two things could coexist in one person. And Ronald Reagan was just a great example of that, and he changed my entire mentality about what leadership at the highest level looks like. Diplomacy. You know, I always thought that was something for the Foreign Service. You had to be an ambassador to be a diplomat. But Ronald Reagan really taught me that diplomacy is for everybody and that it's more about relationships than rhetoric. It looks like friendship more than anything. And we saw in his post-presidency years, all these people, world leaders from all over, came to visit him, not because they had to for protocol or diplomatic reasons, but because they wanted to. They had a friendship with him that they wanted to continue. So we had people like Gorbachev. We had Lech Walesa from Poland, Chancellor Helmut Kohl from Germany, Prime Minister Nakasone from Japan, Prime Minister and Mrs. Brian Mulroney from Canada, even Mother Teresa, who then became a saint, came in to see President and Mrs. Reagan, and what a special day to just be in the presence of somebody who walked so closely with God. Ronald Reagan was also a man of humor. If you've seen any of the clips of the stories he would tell or the jokes he would tell, he was often using self-deprecating humor, making himself the butt of his own joke. But he used to love to tell stories, and sometimes he used them to either break the ice, or sometimes he would make a really important point, but he would use humor or storytelling to do it. He was a man of incredible respect. He didn't care what part side of the political aisle you were on. He could respect you. He could disagree with you without being disagreeable. He was a man of civility. And so presidents from both sides of the aisle were close with him, which was wonderful to see. And of course, he had great respect for women. He talks about his mother as the most important person in his early life. We know about his love for Mrs. Reagan. And he was the first president to appoint a woman to the Supreme Court. And he said he did it not because she was a woman, but because she was the best person for the job. And she happened to be a woman. But he was always really proud of that as well. He was a man of patriotism. You would expect that from your president, but Ronald Reagan, I can tell you, he bled red, white, and blue. He couldn't help but hear patriotic music, and he would tap his toe in time or sing along. He knew every word to every verse, and he was a man who loved America. And so many times I would be in the room with him as patriotic music was being performed, and you would look over and you would see his eyes welling up with tears. This is a man who loved this country and gave his whole life to serving the people of this country. You think of how many times he had heard those songs, and yet they still moved him to his core. This man was a great patriot who loved this nation. He was a man of humility, which may be surprising for somebody who had the top job, but he kept a sign on his desk that said, "There's no limit to what a man can do and where he can go so long as he doesn't mind who gets the credit." And that was the way he lived his life and expected those of us who worked around him to live our lives in that way too. He was a man of incredible gratitude, which again, I think is a surprising trait for somebody at the top. Here he is receiving the Presidential Medal of Freedom in the White House from President Bush after he had become a former president. And here he is on the plane on the way home, and I snapped this picture and loved it because he took off his coat. It's a long flight from DC back to LA, but he left the medal on and he wore it all the way home. To him, he said it was such an honor to serve the people of this great country, and it was something that he really cherished. It wasn't just another memento for his library. It was a true honor, and he wore that medal all the way home. I snapped this picture on the plane, and I actually didn't notice until much later. What is he doing in this photo? Writing a thank you note, yeah. So by the way, he had somebody who would have been happy to do that for him tomorrow, but here's a man who was so full of gratitude, he wanted to say what he wanted to say, how he wanted to say it right then. And he wrote several letters before we even landed back in California. And this picture is very convicting. I don't know, your mom or your grandma may nag you all the time to write thank you notes, but I'll tell you, it's very powerful. In this day and age where all you get is emails and text messages, there's something really special about pen and paper. This is not old school. This is what people do who are at the top of their game still today. I've very recently been to dinners where I'm seated between a congressman or a governor or an ambassador. And by the time I get home and write two letters to people seated on either side of me, I've received letters from both of them. So if you want to stand out and make a difference in this email, text message world, get into the habit of writing letters. This is not old school. This is what the most powerful and important people in the world are doing still today. One of my favorite little mementos from my 10 years working for him is this. It's a doodle. You can maybe tell it's a cowboy, and it's on presidential stationery, and it says, "Merry Christmas to Peggy. Love, Ronald and Nancy Reagan." And I love this doodle, of course, because it's an amazing keepsake, but I love even more the fact that when he gave it to me, he said, "Peggy, I wanted to do something special for you for Christmas, but I didn't know what to do, and you do all my shopping, so I wasn't sure what I could do for you without, including you, so I made this for you, and I hope you like it." And there's nothing I would treasure more from his pen, from his heart, and what a special man showing his gratitude in that way. He was a man of kindness. I had three of my four kids while I was working for him in the office. He was there to welcome my son Taylor, my first, my daughter Courtney, my second, my daughter Paige, my third, my daughter Jocelyn, my fourth. And the kids grew up with President Mrs. Reagan. And the great thing about kids is they don't care what your title is. They don't care how much money you have. They don't care if you're important or not. They know one thing. Do you like me? Do you enjoy being around me? And my kids grew up knowing that Ronald and Nancy Reagan loved having them in their home, in their office. The kids would go and swim in the pool with them. President Reagan took my son to the zoo one day, so I have this picture in my mind of Ronald Reagan pushing my son's stroller flanked by United States Secret Service. pretty crazy. But for my kids, it was very normal. I'd be dressed up in the evening and my son would look up at me and say, Mommy, are you having dinner tonight with Daddy or the President? Like, all very normal to them. But I love the fact that they got to grow up with these incredible people. And really everything I ever need to know about how to live and how to lead, I learned from this man. And he taught me, when I look back on it all, that your legacy is not something that's written after you're gone. It's written with every day of your life. We're not talking about Ronald Reagan because he's gone. We're talking about him because of how he lived. And for all of us, we should lead and live as if our legacy depends upon it, because it does. I got to watch this man interact with the world in amazing ways. This was at a rally. We were leaving, and I was ahead of him with the camera around my neck. I heard the roar of the crowd behind me. I turned around, and I saw people just wanting to reach out, to touch his hand, to shake his hand, to smile or wave at him. This was a man who impacted people wherever he went. And then once he passed away, we saw the outpouring of love and affection and respect from all across the nation and around the world. And most of these people who lined the streets and waited for hours to walk past his flag-draped casket, most of them had never met him, but they knew that he meant something to them because they knew they meant something to him. They knew that every day Ronald Reagan was thinking about how to make lives better and safer for the American people. And so they paid tribute to him in beautiful ways. So I have a few minutes. I can take a few questions. I think somebody's got a microphone around. And then I'll close with one of my favorite Reagan quotes.
So at this time, we're going to start a Q&A. If you guys can just make your way to the back of the room.
Great. That'd be great. Start by telling me your name and where you're from, if you will.
Hello, I'm Theo Batty, and I'm from Dallas, Texas.
Great.
I'm just interested if you can give me a little insight what Ronald Reagan thought of his Vice President George Bush's presidency.
Yeah. Of his presidency.
Yeah,
you know, Ronald Reagan, well, he loved George Bush. They were very good friends. George Bush, post-presidency, even came in to see President Reagan many times, and so they stayed very close personally. Ronald Reagan was very good about not backseat driving. And so whether it was George Bush or anybody who came after him, he knew that that was the toughest job in the world. And he also knew that you can't know what you don't know from the outside, and that only the President of the United States has all the information. And so to second guess a decision he's making or why he's not doing this or saying this, Ronald Reagan, even as a former president, didn't have all that information. So I think he was very eager to give George Bush the benefit of the doubt, even if it was something that maybe he thought he wouldn't have done. But George Bush continued to be very close to Ronald Reagan. In fact, when George Bush passed away, I wrote an op-ed, I think something along the lines of George Bush, Ronald Reagan's ultimate wingman, the wingman that he always had, because George Bush actually came in to see Ronald Reagan as sitting president of the United States. Here's George Bush, sitting president, Ronald Reagan, former president, and George Bush barges through the door and he says, "Now where's my president?" And I just love that, because there was always this respect and this deference from George Bush to Ronald Reagan. And I think Ronald Reagan always reciprocated that respect for him and for what he did.
Thank you.
Thank you, Theo.
Hi, my name is Emiliana Duffy. I'm from Southern California. And my question for you is, what is your favorite, I know it's a hard one, but what is your favorite memory of President Ronald Reagan?
Oh, so hard, just one. It might surprise you, but sometimes it's not the most obvious things. And I think the most special moments for me were riding in the back seat of the car.
Mm-hmm.
Secret Service is driving. There's usually either a lead car or chase car, sometimes both, depending where we were and where we were going. And being in the back of the car with him and turning to my right and seeing that iconic profile and that man there. And sometimes, obviously, we had business to discuss or schedule to talk about. But those moments when it was perfectly quiet, that to me said to me, I trust you. I know you like me. I don't have to convince you. I don't have to entertain you. I don't have to, in any way show myself to you. we're comfortable in silence. And so I almost think that those moments of complete silence in some ways were the most special, because anybody who wasn't familiar with the president, who didn't have a relationship with him, you would never just sit in silence. And so it was those moments, I think, that I really pinched myself and thought, how does a girl from Southern California wind up in a place like this with an opportunity and an honor to serve a man like that? So that may be a little surprising, but that was really special.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Nino Palumbo.
Hi,
I'm from Washington, D.C.
Great.
And I'd like to ask you, after Ronald Reagan's father unfortunately passed away, who did he use as a father figure?
You know, his father, he loved and respected his father and was very good to his father, but his father was an alcoholic and really struggled with work, with consistency in work, with, you know, just a lot of the things that come with being an alcoholic. And so I think very early on, Ronald Reagan didn't really look to his dad as a father figure so much as he looked to him as somebody who had a disease or an illness that really needed help and support. And so maybe that's why he relied so much on his mother. He was a great man of faith. And so he was always very involved in his church. He was always very connected to his pastor. And so whether it was in the White House with Billy Graham, or post-presidency with the pastors that were at Bel Air Presbyterian Church, I think those were always people that ultimately tethered him to bigger things, more important things. And really, he saw as a man of faith that God was his heavenly father and that that was all he really needed, even if he didn't have a father on earth that filled that role for him. But he had great pastors and men of faith that he surrounded himself with throughout his life.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is James Tebow. I'm from
Hi,
New
James.
Hampshire. What was it like being with Mrs. Reagan in the years following President Reagan's death?
Yeah. You know, it was interesting because a lot of times after people pass away, there's the tendency to forget about the person that's left. And so Mrs. Reagan, when the president was gone, I'm sure her phone rang less, people visited less, there was just less. They couldn't access the president through her anymore. And so I'm sure that her phone didn't ring quite as much. And so she was very gracious to me. We had a great relationship all the years that I worked with them. And, you know, Mrs. Reagan was funny because every now and then when I would call, she would say, well, you know, I haven't seen the kids in a while. I was like, hint, hint, hint. Okay, pack the kids up. Let's go up to the house to visit. But, you know, in her elder years too, life is slower, and she went from being on the world stage to a lonely, empty, quiet house. And so she looked for those opportunities for people to come by and visit. And I got to see her just a couple months before she passed away. But every time I would visit, it was the same thing. I got a chance to tell her how grateful I was for her, for him, for allowing me just to be in their world and to serve them and to observe them and to learn so much from them. And I got to tell her that she and her husband changed my life forever and set me on a trajectory that I never could have imagined. And not long before I started actually writing the book, we were having conversations about it. And I told Mrs. Reagan that I had been asked about writing this book. And she was very excited about it and supportive because she knew I saw her husband in a way that most people hadn't. And so she was a lovely lady. A lot of people say she was hard to get along with, but you just had to know what was important to her. And I learned early on, she cared about the truth. She wanted the truth straight up, not sugarcoated. You didn't even have to usually solve it or fix it. She just wanted to know what was going on. And she cared about loyalty. She wanted to know that I was loyal to her and to her husband, and she always had confidence in that. And, you know, before the days of Twitter and things like that, she used to love to get the inside scoop on things. So I'd call her when I'd get scoop on something. I was like, Mrs. Reagan, you didn't hear it from me, but she's like, oh, really? So she always wanted scoop, but she was great. And I would tell her, no, you can't repeat this. And I love what she said in reply. She goes, well, Peggy, I'm a well, not a fountain for information. And so that was her. She was great at keeping secrets, but she did love getting scoop. So whenever I had scoop for her, that was always a good day. But she was a lovely, lovely lady.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Hi, I'm Lauren Petrosky from Vegas, Nevada. I was wondering if there's anything in the book, anything you didn't include in the book about President Reagan.
You know, I would say, so I write about his diagnosis with Alzheimer's because he publicly announced it. And one of the reasons I wrote the book was that people think he left office, he got Alzheimer's, and he died. He left office and he died, but there was 15 years in between. And so what do those 15 years look like? And the first 5 years were really active and busy and very engaged. He traveled all the time. You saw the speeches and the places he went. He announces to the world he has Alzheimer's, and in a way, the whole world starts saying goodbye to him. But I'm still saying good morning to him every day for the next 5 years. And so what did those 5 years look like? And what a great example he was of how a diagnosis was not a death sentence. He continued on as long and as best as he could. And we as the staff were just there to facilitate that. And so I guess to answer your question, some of the things that I left out were just some of the details of his illness. But I tried to tell that story in a way that was revealing, but also respectful. It was a story that he told because he wanted the American people to know, because he wanted research money to go. He wanted people to be able to be cured of it. And he wanted to take away the stigma and the shame that a lot of people had surrounding Alzheimer's. And so I think what I left out of the book were things that would have gone beyond that line of his privacy. But I tried to tell the story still very fully and transparently so that it could help people and encourage people in the same way that he and Mrs. Reagan always wanted to use their challenges to help and encourage people. So I'd say that's what I left
Thank
out.
Thank you.
Hey, I'm Nathan from California.
Excellent.
And I was wondering, do you think we'll ever see another president like Reagan in the United States? And if not, how can we get the United States to an environment to where we could create someone of that caliber of character?
Yeah, that's a good question. I am always an optimist like Ronald Reagan. And so, of course, I do believe America's best days are ahead of us. And, you know, if you would have asked people in the 1970s, is there ever hope for America again? I mean, you've got your own president in Jimmy Carter telling you, you're just going to have to settle for less. You're going to be cold, but put on a sweater. You're going to have to wait in lines, and you're going to have to deal with energy poverty, food shortages, gas lines. It's just the way it's going to be. Nobody would have ever imagined that just on the other side of that would have been Ronald Reagan, who changed the course of the nation and the world. And so I'm an optimist, and I believe that even in the midst of the most difficult times, that gives people an opportunity to make a change and to make a different choice, and that a great leader is maybe waiting right on the other side of this. But to your other part of your question, I always look at, do we deserve a great leader as a nation? And we say we want civility in our politics, but we're often about the politics of personal destruction. Do we get the best and the brightest people, the people of greatest character running for office, or have we made them afraid to run for office because the accusations, true or not, will come after them, after their family, ruin their livelihood, ruin their reputation and their business? And so are we as a society preparing ourselves for greatness, or are we kind of winding up with sometimes not the best choices because we have made politics all about ruining people instead of valuing the experience that they bring? And so I think it's both sides. I think there's you know, this optimism that on the other side of bad can be something really good, but we as a people also need to be prepared for great leadership and get our minds around bringing up the best people, not just who's willing to run the gauntlet of public discrimination or humiliation. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
Great.
Hi, I'm Samantha from Sterling, Virginia.
And Samantha.
When I went to the ranch, I was really shocked to see how humble Ronald Reagan was and how the ranch was just so humble, especially for a president. And I wanted to ask you, what surprised you the most when you first saw the ranch?
Yeah. Well, the first day I was up there, it was really hot and there was no air conditioning in the house. So I remember thinking, wow, at least he could put some air conditioning in. But no, he had fans for the window. And, you know, it goes back to just his humble beginnings. And that was how he was raised. And it's interesting because we look at it and think, oh, that poor kid, he had nothing. But he looks at it as he had everything. He had faith. He had the love of a mother. He always had a roof over his head and, you know, a place to sleep and a meal. And so, and in an era when he thought everybody was poor and everybody was just like him, he learned to be really grateful for even the minimal things. And so I think when he had his choice, would he rather be in the White House for a long weekend or go to California and be at the ranch? I think he felt most comfortable and most free of the trappings of the White House and the trappings of that place of power. And I think it kind of reset him mentally. It probably contributed to the fact that he was a man of gratitude and humility and authenticity, all these things, to be able to go out there, to work hard, to sweat, to ride his horses. And again, that open cathedral, to have an ongoing dialogue with God that he felt like was unobstructed by the place of the White House. And as much as he loved living in the White House, he always knew he was a temporary occupant of it, that it was the people's house, and they graciously allowed him to live there for 8 years. But he never saw that as his home. And I think he was most at home at the ranch because he was most connected to God. He had time with Mrs. Reagan and didn't probably have so many people coming in and out needing his time and attention. But he did love that place, and it was very surprising the first time I went. But still, every time I go, I get up on that hilltop and I feel him there. So I know that he's buried someplace else, but I feel him in very alive ways up at the ranch. It's a very special place. If you get a chance to go, please go.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I want to leave you with one of my favorite quotes of his, and I think this kind of sums up what I want to tell you, because it sums up basically what he wanted to tell us. He spoke at the 1992 Republican National Convention in Houston, Texas, and these were some of the final words he left us with. And he says, "Whatever else history may say about me when I'm gone, I hope it will record that I appealed to your best hopes, not to your worst fears, to your confidence rather than your doubts." And so much of, especially the political arena these days, what do? They appeal to your fear and to your doubt. Ronald Reagan was a different kind of leader, and I challenge all of you to be that kind of leader who appeals to people's best hopes and to their confidence. And I think that's one of the reasons that he was so effective, so beloved, and is remembered and cherished and you know, remembered and celebrated still today. So thank you so much. You're a fantastic audience, especially at the end of a long day. So thank you.